With me is Ms. Pegisu Khumalo, who is representing Investec. Welcome.
Thank you so much. It's such a privilege for me to be at this special tribute where we're paying tribute to one of the greatest men of Africa. I mean, a world leader, the greatest statesman that I think we all have been privileged to live in his time.
The first thing I would like to know, when you heard the news of Utata passing, what was your reaction to them?
Look, I think I was on my way home, and it really hit me hard. And I think as much as it was the inevitable, and we all knew that he was an elderly person, and it was inevitable. But I think we still hoped that God was going to keep him because we needed him in our midst, and because of the person that he is, we just wanted to have him in our presence. And for me personally, I've had a very personal journey with Utata. I was very privileged that he took me under his wings, educated me, and I became the woman that I am today because of his influence and support.
Now, Utata is one of the people who spoke strongly against the abuse of women and children. How did he inspire you as a young woman in South Africa?
Utata inspired me in so many ways. First of all, I think the fact that he recognized a promise in me and made me realize that I could dream bigger, that I could get an education. And today my life has changed, and I truly believe that life does change. I mean, education does change lives. And Tata always said this to me, that if you do educate people, their lives will change and the nation will change. So that was one thing that changed me and influenced me. In terms of his passion and just support and his voice against, you know, people that abuse women and children, I think for me, it was so critical that we had somebody like himself, a moral figure in the community, coming out strongly against people who abuse women and children. I think everybody in South Africa deserves to be respected. Their rights need to be respected. I'm a mother, and every day I wake up, my first prayer that I say is about the safety and security of my child, and then myself, and then my mother, and then all the other women that I know in my life. And I really do believe that the violence that we see today is not needed. If Tata was still with us, and I hope his spirit will linger in our hearts when we do these things, we'll actually remember that this is one of the things that he was totally against, and he didn't want it to exist in our communities. And I think as communities, we need to take introspections, we need to empower our men, you know. As much as we focus a lot about women empowerment, I think there's a lot that needs to be done in terms of empowering young men so that they can understand that you need to respect your mother, you need to respect your aunt, you need to respect your cousin as a baby, as your cousin. So there's a respect there, and there's a bond that you cannot feel that you can abuse that.
Now I hear that you're speaking, you had an encounter with Utata, and one of the things that we enjoyed as the people is the fondest moments that people keep sharing. What was your fondest moment with Utata Mandela?
I think my fondest moment, and this is something that I will carry with me, and I think it's fond in that there was a bit of me that was growing up in it, but again, it just showed. Here was a guy who was sitting in the company of the former state president, Bill Clinton, and I was sitting with him at the table, and we were having lunch, and all of a sudden, there was this plate of prawns put in front of me. And I had not seen prawns in my life. I mean, the last time I saw prawns was in, you know, in my mom's madam's kitchen when we were cleaning them up. And then all of a sudden, this plate of prawns is placed in front of me. And I looked around and I thought, oh my gosh, if I touch these things, they might pop out of my plate, or I might shoot them across and they jump on Bill Clinton or something. I had all kinds of things. I think he sensed the uncomfortableness that I was going through. He looked to me and he said to me, you know what? All will be well. Do you want to use my bread knife? And I think at that opportunity, I said to him, Dada, can they just take it away and just bring me bread or salad or something like that? So for me, that there was I in the company of probably the two most powerful men at the time, you know, because they were both state presidents. But he was also able to reach out to somebody who was very naive, to a very different environment, because I come from very humble beginning, rural humble beginnings. But I think he reached out. And, you know, for somebody who was in prison, to have that charisma and to have that social etiquette. So there was nothing that Dada didn't know, and there was no situation that he couldn't handle. And that's the beauty, and that's the the most special thing about him that I think we're all gonna miss. He just had this amazing charisma and just specialness in him that it didn't matter what it was. He was soft at times, he was hard at times, and when he was hard as well, you still loved him because he was just so lovable.
Okay, now a lot of remarkable things happened when Utata passed. Businesses closed down in honor of him, and on Sunday so many other businesses are going to be on shutdown. How has this or the passing of Utata affected the business?
Look, I think it's been interesting times. I think obviously there's been a lot of communication coming through from the presidency that, you know, people can still be at work. But I think as business, we've also allowed an opportunity for people to mourn the passing of Dada, because I think it's important and I think it's vital. So those that choose to go and pay their respects, whether it was at the memorial service yesterday, whether it's at the union buildings today and for the next 2 days, I think those people should be allowed that space. But obviously taking into account that business is business and productivity is important and the economy needs to run and it needs to go forward. So we need to make sure that if we do, we do keep some people in the workplace so that, you know, that machine can turn. But we do want to reach out to people and make sure that people can actually pay their respects, because everybody from young, old, should be able to be given an opportunity to pay their respects to Tata Madiba.
I think lastly, what I would like to know is that as business people, how are you going to make sure that you carry on with Tata's legacy?
Look, one of the things that I think Dada was brilliant at, and I saw him in action, I had the privilege of seeing him in action a number of times. He was not scared to pick up a phone and call Mr. Stephen Kosa from Investec if he wanted a school or a clinic to be built. You know, he was not scared if he wanted people to be sponsored. I am a sponsored student of Investec Bank, and that call came from Dada Madiba to Stephen Kosa. So I think business should be conscious about their CSI programs or their corporate social investment programs, and they should actually, you know, build on the momentum and build on the legacy that Tata left. I think they should actually increase their commitment in terms of what they're doing for the broader community. We should also be mindful of that he was a partner of business, so there were a lot of things that he did to enable us to thrive as the private sector. And I think that the communication between public sector and private sector should be increased, because when he was around, that's what it was about. It was about a partnership which he held from the public sector point of view, and business got engaged and they got involved. And I think that the current leadership should continue that legacy of involving business in everything that they do, and business should equally do the same. Respect and engage, you know, the public sector on critical matters. You know, as a country, this is a turning point for us. We've lost a hero, we've lost our father, you know, but we also have issues that we need to deal with, and these issues are serious. Whether it's high unemployment, it's the abuse against women and children, our economy not growing at growth rates that we'd like it to grow, we need to step up and we need to realize that some of the fundamental principles that Dada left us with, we need to take those and actually keep them alive and make sure that these contemporary issues that are affecting us as South Africa, we're able to address those issues with the style and just respect and just the way that did things.
Thank you very much for your time.